I am your host, Nicole Will, and we thank you for joining us as we navigate the world with your aging loved one. We are here to come alongside elders, family members, and the senior living community as we explore the world of aging and elder care with helpful resources, informative interviews, and approachable conversations. We get to do this together, so join us on our journey, and this is the Will Gather podcast. I am so happy to introduce to you Catherine Wells, CEO of Serenity Engage. Catherine, thank you so much for joining me today.
I am delighted to be here.
I'm so thankful that you and I get to have another conversation. We have talked before. We had commonalities in our passions and our love of this community, and I couldn't wait to be able to highlight what you guys are doing with Serenity Engage in your company and how you're changing the way we engage with our loved ones. It is a game changer and so needed. Your heart is so kind, and your business was created from the motivation of the experience with your own mom. Can you tell us about that? How did you come to this place of creating your company?
Yeah, it was an interesting story, but I don't think it's an uncommon one, right, Nicole? Yeah. I mean, I think we talked about that before. When we're going through it, we feel like we're the only one who's ever gone through this senior care journey, right? And we're the only ones experiencing these issues. So I was just living my life. I was a software marketing executive. I live in the same state as my parents, but about an hour away, just going on about life. And one day my dad called me up and said, you know, your mother's really struggling to balance the checkbook. And I thought, well, that's really weird because she's done the checkbook her whole life without, she gets it down. She will not have a penny error. She absolutely refuses.
So
she's a very stubborn Italian woman.
Yes.
So that was our first kind of heads up. And over the years, things started getting slowly, more things like that began to happen. And eventually my dad, being just an amazing man, was able to get her in to see a neurologist. And she was diagnosed with Alzheimer's. And she was pretty early stage at that point. But, you know, shortly after, it got worse and worse, and we had to move her into a memory care facility down the road from my dad. And I realized how difficult it is to stay in touch with what's happening in their daily life. So I went from talking to my mom every day to not really being able to get a hold of her very easily or find out what was going on in her life unless I drove an hour and was able to visit, which I did every weekend. But you know, you can't do that every single day. And it was a challenge. But then we realized, and this again is not uncommon, we realized that then my dad could not live on his own either. And that happens very often. So anyone who might be listening to this, if your parents are in this situation or someone that you know, let them know this is normal. When one spouse moves into senior living or even passes, the other spouse, we often find in the older years that they either really flourish on their own or we find out that they aren't really able to live on their own. And that's what happened with my dad. And that's the more common one, that they really aren't able to live on their own. So then we had to move dad into assisted living. And that was after, of course, 4 ER visits and, you know, a lot of heartache between my brothers, I have 3 brothers who are incredible and they did so much work. I'm the only girl in the family. I'm the youngest. And my dad leaned on me. He had a relationship with mom where she took care of all the details of life. And so he kind of expected me to step into that role. And I did, because you have to. I had people say to me, are you enabling him? And I thought, you know, maybe I am a little bit. But geez, the guy is 75 years old. His wife has Alzheimer's. He's losing the love of his life right in front of his eyes. Yeah. And if I can just give him some comfort, I want to be able to do that. Yeah. So as we had dad in assisted living, mom in memory care, I'm in a city farther away. We ended up moving them a little closer to me, but I still couldn't get there every day. I realized how many things I was missing out on. Mm-hmm. I was missing out on the moments and memories that were happening that most of the time I never knew about unless a caregiver told me on the weekend. I didn't know if the doctor rounded, and that caused me anxiety. Mm-hmm. I didn't know if my mom got her hair cut when I had requested, and that's the one thing that made her happy was to have her hair cut and feel good. So coming from the tech world, I know that in the tech world, we've solved the problem of disparate teams working together. And I'm looking at all of these people who come in and provide these incredible services for our parents, and they don't really talk to each other. They all chart. So all the charting is there. They are, all the medical information is there. You have record that they showed up, mm-hmm. but there's not a conversation happening between them. And that's what I felt was missing. And there was no easy way for family to get in touch with pretty much anyone. It's very sad, and I'm not sure how this is happening, and I see it changing with COVID, but family is often told, just call us. Just call us. You can reach us anytime. You can talk to your loved one anytime. Many of them have phones in their rooms. My mom didn't. She was in the memory care unit. Mm-hmm. She was nonverbal the last 2 years of her life anyway. Mm-hmm. So I couldn't have called her to ask how she was doing. My dad, on the other hand, was quite verbal. He wanted to talk a lot. But when I asked him how he was doing from the social emotional perspective, mm-hmm. I would get things like, I don't see anyone for days. Mm-hmm. They haven't fed me. Mm-hmm. I don't know who my doctor is. And I knew his doctor had been there the day before, maybe, or, you know, something. So it was very interesting to me to get in his world and understand that he didn't know what was going on, mm-hmm. and I needed to be his advocate. And I was the power of attorney along with another brother, so that helped quite a bit. So I could step in. If you don't have power of attorney, anyone listening to this, if you're in a situation like mine, please, please, please have the conversation. Somebody needs to have power of attorney, or you cannot step in and advocate for them and make a difference. Right. So I really, really encourage that. And there's two power of attorneys. There's mm-hmm. healthcare and there's financial. Mm-hmm. It'd be great if you can get both, but at a minimum, get the healthcare.
Yes, I agree. Those are, and plan ahead if you can. And if you can't, start the conversation as soon as possible.
Yeah. So let me ask you a question. Mm-hmm. You're young.
Yeah.
Have you guys talked about it? Have you planned ahead for what your aging life might look like?
That's a really good question. We have a little bit. We have kids. I have two kids. And so we have set up our will and advanced directives and things like that. But we haven't really had a serious conversation about what does aging life look like? We have conversations with our parents to some extent, but like you, they're in the throes of managing care for their parents, and talking about it feels a little scary, even mm-hmm. though we need to, but it's opened up more conversation because they're walking through that journey with their parent, and they've, you know, my grandparents, and we have in the past had to make some hard decisions. And so it definitely moves you to have more conversation that you wouldn't have had before. It's a good question.
I really like what you said too, that your parents are in the throes of dealing with their parents, mm-hmm. and that it can be a scary conversation, mm-hmm. but it shouldn't have to be. Mm-hmm. That's the big aha right there, right. I think.
Right.
And I hope people listening to this really, really hear that. It shouldn't be scary. Mm-hmm. There's nothing scary. It's going to happen anyway. And if you ignore it, that doesn't mean it won't happen.
Right.
So, I mean, God willing, it will happen anyway.
Yeah.
And as you age, don't you want to be in control mm-hmm. of the way you age? Mm-hmm. I have not done my planning, so I'm mm-hmm. sitting over here, you know, that's why I asked the question.
Right.
But I'm going to. Mm-hmm. It's on the docket to be done and done sooner than later.
Yeah.
Both my husband and I have parents with Alzheimer's. So we both have lost our parents, but it's in our genetics.
Yeah.
So we're definitely aware of mm-hmm. what that might mean for us.
Mm-hmm. That's such an interesting point. We could really almost look at that as another step of planning like we have our will or healthcare directives. It could almost be aging directives or whatever we want to title that if I need to move into a senior community, here's what I think I would like. When I'm not able to make that decision myself, here's what I enjoy doing. Here's where I can generally see communities I would enjoy, or my desire is to stay home, or whatever that is. Mapping that out ahead of time when you are in sound mind could be a really interesting discussion, you know?
It is. And we're talking about a couple of different things at Serenity. And I also wear another hat called Mavericks of Senior Living. At Mavericks of Senior Living, we have collaboration cohorts, and we're on cohort number 2 right now. And the very focused topic of that cohort is transitioning into senior care. And so we talk about, how do you plan for that? What does it look like for you? What? How do you want communication to happen? How do you want your family to be involved?
Right.
I can tell you, my dad would complain to his friends that I was taking over his life. I was making all of his decisions, and they would call me and, you know, gently say, maybe you could back off a little. And I'm like, I wish you could see it on this end, because I'm not controlling anything.
Right.
It's how he's feeling.
Yes.
And he had no one to vent to. So it's interesting. It's such an interesting journey. And mostly I want people to know that no matter what they experience, you're not alone.
Right.
And that the journey looks different for everybody. The idea of, you talked about, you know, creating your plan where, do I want to stay at home? Do I want to move into a community? There's pros and cons to both. Right. And I think that neither are exclusive either. I always advocate for stay at home as long as you can. Transition into care when it's needed. And I had the best advice from somebody when we were deciding when to put mom into care. He said to me, Kathy, you move your mom when you guys can't do it anymore. Not when she needs it, because she probably needs it now. But when you guys just can't do it anymore, mom. And then, you know, we had to kind of talk through that. Like, my mom would never have wanted to affect our lives in that way. Also, we couldn't give her the 24/7 type of care that she would have needed. And that is, it's a financial drain, it's a physical drain, it's an emotional drain. And yet it's energizing because you love that person. But that we cannot ignore the impact on our lives and our jobs and our relationships. And I think it's just a very important thing to balance. And there's no perfect time to do it.
There is.
I will say my husband's mom opted to move in to senior care, and she could, or senior living, and she could not wait. She was so excited because she didn't have to clean. Someone was going to cook for her. She would have friends to play bridge with. She got involved in the theater. So I think for everyone, there's a different personality type, and what can you afford as well? So, you know, planning all of those things, there's so many moving parts as we age. It's really important to kind of at least try to map out high level. You don't need to get all the details, but try to map it out.
Yeah, those details come right as you walk through it. But you had such a good point when you were talking about, there are a lot of commonalities that we face, and it's so individualized. It's this community of, you're not alone, but yet everyone's story is a little bit different. And understanding that, and all the different emotions that can go into that transition, what do you see are some of those emotions that come up for people when they're faced with that?
Oh, so many. And so many that you didn't realize you had. So regret for not doing more before. My son was 12 maybe when his grandmother was beginning to experience Alzheimer's. And he wrote a composition for school, 12 or 13. He wrote a composition for school talking about how he wished he had been a better grandchild. And it just broke my heart. I'm tearing up right now. And he was an amazing grandchild. But I think there's a lot of regret. I think there's guilt. I think there's questioning. Am I doing the right thing? Am I a bad person? Is this good for her or him? Are they going to like it there? What if they don't like it there? Can we afford this? How are we going to work as a family to manage this? Who in our family wants to be part of managing their care and who wants to be a little bit at arm's length, because that's how they deal with things. And boy, learning to accept the new dynamics in your own family and accept people, and this is important, accepting your siblings and your parents for who they are and who they are not.
Yes.
And taking off the expectation that every family member should step up and do X, Y, and Z all the time, it's not fair. It's not healthy. It's not who they are. Mm-hmm. So learning how to figure out and navigate your own dynamics again with your family of origin, that, you know, we all grow up together. We have our fights. I had a brother. We didn't talk for 20 years. Thank goodness we're reunited.
Yeah.
And I have regret over that, but now, you know, we reunite and shortly after mom gets Alzheimer's and now we're kind of navigating our life as siblings together again. Yes. So it can be joyful. Mm-hmm. And that's the other thing I would say is look for the joy.
That's good advice.
You know, one of the reasons I created Serenity, I said early on, was the fact that I was missing out, we were missing out as a family on those moments in my mom's life, that she was doing things like sitting down at the piano. She was not a piano player. She would sit down like she owned the piano, and she didn't play well, but she acted like she did.
Right.
So, like, to me, that's a moment I would not have wanted to miss.
Yeah.
And if a caregiver had not told me on a Saturday afternoon when I was visiting, who just happened to be the caregiver that was there when that happened, I would never have known that. Yeah. And I would have missed out on so much.
Right.
And those are the things that we created Serenity for as well.
Yes.
So to get a little photo right in that moment of mom playing the piano and a little note from the caregiver, hey, look what your mom's doing. She's having a blast. Like, that would have made my entire day rather than having this constant anxiety and worry, which it just is. And maybe, you know, big generalization, but I think more often for women, especially if you're a mom, you've stepped into that role. Not even if you're not a mom, it doesn't matter. Mm-hmm. Your mom is so important in life that we just have this kind of nagging, ongoing anxiety when they're in senior care and not able to advocate for themselves.
Right.
And you know that you're the person, you're their person.
Yeah, it's that unknown, right? When we don't know what's happening, our imagination can go wild and we can tell ourselves stories that aren't true, and just having the peace of mind of what's really happening. And we'll get into why it's so important to have that communication and that trust, but let's establish so people know what we're talking about when you talk about Serenity Engage. How does it work and what is it? Because it's such a valuable resource and gives people that peace of mind when they are faced with all of those emotions and that unknown. And we'll talk about that a little bit and talk about why that's so important.
Yeah, thank you. I get so wrapped up in it's, you know, my daily life. So I didn't even think about describing it, of course. So Serenity is a HIPAA compliant private group messaging application. Download it on your phone. We're getting a browser version out there shortly as well. But it's like any other texting app that you might have, and you have direct access to the care team. And you can message whenever, and they can message back whenever. I often hear families say, I can't ask the care staff to do this because they're already so stretched. And my response is, well, this actually gives them time back in their day because they can send you these quick messages rather than having to wait for a break, remember to call you. Oftentimes they call the wrong sibling. Unfortunately, the books are hard to keep up to date. Mm-hmm. I have a brother with schizophrenia and he's part of the family, so he's on the list. But I would always say, please call me first. Please call me first, because I need to be able to synthesize this. And if I can communicate it to him before you, mm-hmm. it always is better for him. It's very difficult for them to know that. To know, you know, that they have high turnover. Let me also say that. Yeah. So there's a lot of people who are turning over in this right. industry. Yeah. I'm hoping to impact that with Serenity mm-hmm. for a lot of reasons. Mm-hmm. One, I think Serenity itself will impact that, because when you have communication with the family, you're more intrinsically involved in your job, and they fall in love with our parents. Believe yeah. me, when both of my parents passed, the care staff grieved. And I watched it happen with every resident there. And if you can imagine living a life where you're caring for these people and they pass and you have to grieve them, it's hard. So for family to be able to have this channel, this very open channel of communication with the care staff, gives family the opportunity to say thank you on a regular basis. Oh my gosh, you're the best. Yeah. I'm gonna bring you a Starbucks the next time I come. I can't believe you did that for my mom. I so appreciate you. You know, just sharing the appreciation is something they don't get today. Right. Many of them are in organizations where if family wants to share appreciation monetarily, they actually have to put that into an overall fund for all the caregivers. And that's great, and I understand all the reasons why. You just can't create weird dynamics like that inside. Yeah. But it does mean that there's not a lot of opportunity for family to just verbalize their appreciation for the care staff that's doing the hard work. So right. I think Serenity will impact the turnover rates. And I also think that it will improve quality of care for our loved ones.
Yeah.
Because we actually, as family, will have a seat at the table, which right now we have a seat at the table once a quarter, yep. usually care at a conference. Care conference. And if you've experienced a care conference, many of them go like this. Okay, let's sit down. Your dad is on these care levels. This one has increased. Your bill's going to increase by $50. Do you have any questions?
Yeah.
That's kind of how they go. Mm-hmm. And it's sad right. Because it's not what they want either. I think they actually, I don't think this is a people problem. I think it's a systems problem.
I agree. And I think it's always, quote unquote, you can't see my air quotes, been done that way. Mm-hmm. And it's time. And there's a desire that the care team really wants that personal connection and that ongoing communication. Because typically that care conference, you're allotted 15 minutes max to go through all of the disciplines to give a report, essentially. And it's not that time when really brainstorming or conversation can even happen.
Yeah. And if there is any of that conversation, it's often, what do you think we could be doing differently? Mm-hmm. It's not a true, genuine brainstorming, right? Mm-hmm. It's like they want tasks that they could be doing differently.
Yeah. Yeah.
Very task oriented. And there's a big push in senior care for person-centered care. Mm-hmm. I'm a huge fan. I think purpose-centered care is probably more aligned with where we want to go.
Yeah.
And I think it's going to take a long time for the systems to catch up from being task-centered to person-centered right. to purpose-centered.
Yeah. It's exciting, though, that we're moving in that direction. And you kind of mm-hmm. referenced this a little bit before, but COVID did push us a little bit more into that place of needing to find new ways and better ways of communicating. That is the foundation of how we build trust. Wouldn't you say? How do you see, when you have that level of communication, what then happens with that trust level for your patients that use that?
So such a great question. So we actually have an ebook that maps out a guideline roadmap for the first 14 days of care and what communication should look like mm-hmm. in that time. The reason we did that is because 80% of lawsuits against senior living providers are related to the first 14 days of care. And it's not that they're providing horrible care. It's that they did not build trust. They didn't lay a good ground framework. They did not involve the family. And it's a very, very, very simple fix. Very simple. And that fix is literally understand that the day the family puts their loved one in, they're going to have anxiety. Mm-hmm. Send them a photo that night along with a little message. A lot of caregivers are doing this via text, which is not HIPAA compliant, and the communities have no oversight. And that actually puts the communities at risk, right, and is one of the reasons communities don't want their caregivers communicating with family. So we need to stop that. Mm-hmm. So using a tool like Serenity that is HIPAA compliant eliminates the outside texting and focuses the communication where everyone can see it. So the whole staff can see that a photo went out of Orly, which was my mom's name, and a cute little note about her. And then the next morning, send either a photo or just an update. Hey, you know, your dad slept really well last night. He did well his first night and he's up having breakfast. It just calms the family member's anxiety. And it also begins to build that trusted relationship that, yes, I'm going to get communication from this mm-hmm. community. I speak with family members every day who say, I was sold on the fact that they were going to communicate with me on a really regular basis. And here's what they do. They robocall, they do mass emails, and they do them once a week. That is not regular communication, and it's not even communication. It's pushing information at me. It's not helping me understand how my mom is doing. Right. The sad part about that is so many of those communities think that they've got the communication box checked because they're doing those things. And there's such a disconnect between what family wants mm-hmm. and is expecting and what the communities are providing. Now, you mentioned COVID. So COVID has changed a lot of that. It's still not there. These are big systems. In all honesty, the smaller home environments are doing much, much better during COVID. They are faring so well during COVID because the small group homes are generally somewhere between 8 and 16 people in a home. Mm-hmm. They're already quarantined together. They don't have to stay in their room. They never had to go on quote lockdown other than right. family couldn't come in. But they still had all their regular routine. Mm-hmm. They had the same people around. They were interacting. And the smaller group home owners are much more open to communicating with family than the larger organizations are. Large organizations have a lot of pros and a lot of cons, and same with the small group homes. So this is something that anyone listening, if you're on this journey, it's a decision that you make at some point. Yeah. Do they go into a large community where there's a beautiful saltwater pool and there's a chef on site and, you know, all the glorious, beautiful things? Or do they go into a smaller group home where they have more social, emotional interaction, but they don't have those things? And it's neither are exclusive. A lot of people go into the bigger ones first and then move into smaller ones later in their progression of their disease, whatever that is, dementia or Parkinson's or whatever it is. And then if you go back to the bigger location concept, in COVID, it's not faring well because everyone has to be in their own room. They can't go back to the dining room. They don't get to see people. There's very little social interaction. And we know already the results are there that people are dying from loneliness and isolation. And I know that if my parents had lived into the COVID era, both of them would have passed during this time because of that. It's absolutely heartbreaking, and it's not necessary. There are ways we can re-engineer the systems. There's so much there to talk about, but let me talk about, since we're talking about building trust, the larger organizations are terrified of being sued, okay? And people do sue, mm-hmm. and it's sad that they sue when they shouldn't be suing. Mm-hmm. If somebody did something wrong, there are definitely bad actors. In every industry, there are bad actors. They should be held accountable. But there are some frivolous lawsuits, and many of even the frivolous lawsuits have designed a system now where communities literally do not want the direct line care staff to talk to you as a family member. And that does not provide good care for our loved ones. Yeah. And my response to them is, let's teach them how to talk to family, what's right, what's not right, what's okay to say, what's not okay. And they do that in some training, but if you give them an app like Serenity, many of these caregivers are going to be sending photos and little updates constantly and just streamlining the things like, is my dad out of Depends? Do I need to order more? You know, just does mom need some more Ensure? Like that literally could have taken three different voicemail tags to get some of that information before. And this is a 2-second text message. Yeah. Everything solved. So I'm really focused on how do we create an environment where the care staff can communicate with family. Doesn't mean they're the be-all, end-all. It doesn't mean they're taking care of the higher level problems, but they are your first line of communication about what's happening with your loved one. And I want to see that channel open up. And we can do that if we give them the education that they need to know what's appropriate, what's not appropriate. When you take a photo, for example, be careful. When you take a photo, see what's in the background. Is there someone running around naked behind them? Because my mom used to take off her top and run around and they would chase her and put her top back on, but that's dementia. Mm-hmm. That happens. Mm-hmm. So I think there's enormous education opportunity and it will only serve to build trust. Right. And that I think is another reason there are frivolous lawsuits. Is because there isn't any trust.
I love what you said. Let's teach how to communicate appropriately. You talked about the care team that was so sad when your mom passed away, and I can attest to that. When my grandma passed away, the funeral was filled with the aides and the nursing assistants that cared for her. It wasn't, right? She had lived long enough, so there wasn't a big community of friends. But all of the aides were there, and they are the lifeline of that communication. They know the routine. They know when they're having a good day, when they're feeling a little bit off, and empowering them to be able to communicate in an effective way, and that their communication is really valued, not only deters that turnover, because if you feel valued and what your input is a part of this team and we really appreciate what you say, that can be life-changing for people in their career and in those relationships. And so that is such a good point to that. Why not then let's equip people with the skills to communicate?
And isn't that what it's all about? Mm-hmm. What you just said, Nicole, was so profound because that's what it's all about. The quality of care, the quality of life for the person that we're all surrounding, providing this care for.
Yeah, that's the goal, right? That is what it's about. That's why we do this. That's why we have older adult communities. That's what it is. If you boil it down, what you said, it's so true. And we get lost in all of the other stuff. And I get it, rightly so, that there's a lot we have to consider. There's a lot of policy and we understand that. But when we really boil it down and what the mission is, to just keep remembering that, you know?
Yes. Always.
I love how you talked about they check the communication box, right? And I was guilty of it as a director. I would send out my newsletter and I'm thinking I'm totally communicating with my family members, right? We've done that. We're communicating. But really, how busy people are, the different meetings, the different corporate compliance, the different health regulations, we are strapped for time. It does feel like answering a lot of individual phone calls or looking up contact information in a chart does take time. And we do life, when you really think about it, I do all of my life on my cell phone, essentially. Mm-hmm. I make my calls, I've got my calendar, I schedule my appointments, like everything I do is on my cell phone. Why wouldn't we want to then communicate with our care team and with our loved one in that way. It's the most, every other industry has figured out that this is the most efficient way to interact. And why not bring that into this industry to make it efficient and to make it, again, you can't see my air quotes, up with the times.
Keep up with the times. Let's modernize. Yes. Let's modernize. And let's talk about that for a second.
Yeah.
Earlier you said it's the absence of communication that scares people. Mm-hmm. And that is so true. And when they're getting general information, maybe it appeases a teeny tiny bit, but it really doesn't give them peace of mind. There is a shift in demographics that's happening now.
Yeah.
This would not be happening if this demographic shift wasn't also happening. And there was a lot of conversation about this by some forward thinkers in the industry pre-COVID. There were events going on that were about transforming senior living, just the whole idea that it is time to change. So pre-COVID, here's a couple statistics for you. Pre-COVID, 60% of CEOs of senior living communities were set to retire within the next 5 years. Mm-hmm. Most of that was just aging out. So kind of done, they spent their career there, they're kind of done. So pre-COVID, if COVID had never happened, in these 5 years, we would be seeing a huge shift anyway, because the younger people who are stepping into those roles are just like what you said, I live my life on my phone. Why don't we have more modern tools in this industry? Mm-hmm. And they're bringing them left and right. So COVID comes along and that 60% is actually accelerating how quickly they're moving on, because they've done their career. This is a stressful time. Let someone else do it, right? Yeah. So that demographic is changing. Leadership and foresight and technology savvy people. Mm-hmm. I can't tell you how many times I get on a Zoom call with a community and they don't have a camera on their laptop. And I'm like, I'm blown away. Mm-hmm. How do you have a laptop without a camera on it? And they don't know how to use Zoom. So we end up on the phone, and that's fine. That's fine. It's just very interesting as an outsider to look at that and say, how can we accelerate and give them the ability to provide more care, free up their time by giving them tools that exist everywhere else in the world?
Right.
We have a customer who is a very, very large organization, and she is the one of the executive directors is just beyond over the moon because of Serenity. She used to manage her family communication via a spreadsheet. So every week, 172 residents at that one community, she would be calling the family members and go through a spreadsheet. And she's so excited. She said, what takes me literally 2 seconds in Serenity would have easily taken me 3 to 5 minutes per mm-hmm. communication. And so you start adding up that kind of time savings. And you were talking about all the systems and they don't have time. It's true they don't have time. We actually want to give them time back.
Right. Typically, when you do have a loved one also in a memory care, or not even a memory care, in a senior community, and you call, you don't always reach them, but you might reach the nurse's desk, let's say, or the main office. Mm-hmm. And the chance of being able to actually talk to your loved one is really minimized, because then mm-hmm. that phone is, you know, 50% of the time not even being answered because they're busy working with your loved one, rightly so. If you mm-hmm. were to catch someone, then they're trying to find where that person is, and they could be in an activity, and then we're taking time. It's just, there's just not how it's always been, is really the family is pushing that way forward of, this isn't working for me. I'm a busy individual as well, and I also don't have the time to try to navigate this and find my loved one when I really want to be able to have that conversation or hear how they're doing. There was in a caregiver group that I am a part of, just an example is someone had talked about they had placed their mom in a home. Out of, you know, the three nursing homes that they were trying to decide, their mom was just so unhappy and crying. And the family was so overwhelmed and they felt so sad that they had to finally decide on a home, make that transition. Well, the staff at that home showed them then a video of their mom that had stopped crying when they left. She was smiling. She was happy. And the family said, if it was not for that image of me seeing that my loved one was okay, it fundamentally changed their experience and their relationship with their senior living facility. And I think it was probably not done on a HIPAA compliant exchange, but that's just an example of the image and the video. You can't fabricate that. That is a real picture of time and emotion and what's happening. And it's so important because that really changes the family's trust, right? They can rest easy that, okay, my loved one is content and it's going to be okay. Makes all the difference.
So well said. And that happens all the time too. That's a very, very common thing, that your loved one will, I don't want to say throw a fit, but they definitely don't want you to leave. Yeah. So they're going to manipulate the situation as they can.
Yeah.
Right. My dad was the king of this. Mm-hmm. And as soon as we left, we were told over and over that he was fine as soon as we left, but we didn't know. And that's the difference. Mm-hmm. If you are just verbally telling the family, mm-hmm. it's how does the family really know? You know, it might give them a little sense of peace, but if they see that picture, it changes everything.
Right.
And I love that they did that. And I have to tell you, they aren't the only ones who get text messages that are not HIPAA compliant. The other thing I tell communities who don't want their caregivers on here is they're doing it anyway, whether you think they are or not.
Right.
I promise you, I have not talked to one community where I did not know I had evidence that mm-hmm. somebody was texting family members.
Yeah.
And then you have no idea what they're saying, and it puts you at much greater risk.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And that's because we've set up a system of mistrusting our frontline care staff with communication.
Yeah.
Let's fix that. That's easy. Let's fix that.
And bring it all into the fold and create that team. I think that's what I really appreciate about it, because you not only looked at let's give senior living communities a way to communicate, but it also is that hospice, which is such a big part of the care team mm-hmm. for people, and those home care agencies, and really mm-hmm. let's bring in everyone that has interaction, because a lot of times those don't fully communicate with each other because different schedules. So it lets everyone that's having that touch point come together.
Exactly. You know, when somebody goes on hospice care, and all of those are good examples. Like earlier I said, I didn't know when the doctor rounded. I would have appreciated a message in serenity. Hey, saw your dad today. He's doing great. Mm-hmm. You know, no news, no updates. Perfect. That's all I need to know, right?
Mm-hmm.
So then you kind of move towards they're degrading in their health a little bit, and it looks like hospice care is our next step. What happens when that happens, a lot of people are very unaware that hospice, if someone's in senior living, hospice comes into senior living and they provide their service on top of the services that the senior living staff provides. So it's an extra layer of care. There are anywhere from 3 to 9 people who suddenly surround your loved one, and they are a nurse, a few CNAs usually, different CNAs, a spiritual guidance person, a chaplain of some sort. There's often a pet therapist, an art therapist, a massage therapist. So there can be up to 9 people from hospice and a social worker
mm-hmm.
who suddenly call you as the family member. Out of the blue, you're like, okay, who are you? You're picking up the phone constantly. Okay, oh, you're the social worker. Okay, nice to meet you. Okay, you're so-and-so. Nice to meet you. Nice to meet you. You don't remember any of this. You're a family member. You're in kind of shock or surprise or sadness about the fact that your loved one's transferring into hospice care and you don't know what hospice care is. All you know is what you've been told, which is it means they're going to die in 6 months, mm-hmm. in the next 6 months. And that is not always true.
Right.
So I really wish there was more education around hospice mm-hmm. care and that you can graduate from hospice. And many people rebound when hospice comes in because of the extra care, but then you will see a reduction in most of them. But that's where Serenity comes in, where if they can introduce themselves in a channel, the family has a photo of them, a little intro from them, and they can always go back and reference that. If they don't know who Brittany is, they look back and say, okay, Brittany's the social worker. Okay, good. I know that I'm going to call Brittany for these issues. Okay, who is Cheryl? Cheryl is the chaplain. Oh, good. Okay, I need to talk to her about getting my dad's last rites. That'll be really important to him. Mm-hmm. So, like, these kinds of things are hard for family, but the systems are set up so that there's not a lot of communication happening between the senior living and the hospice provider. Oftentimes, I would show up in my own experience, I would show up and they would not know if hospice had rounded or not. And I'm like, how could you not know? They have to come into the building. Well, it's very easy for them to not know because they're running around doing all of these other things. And it's not an easy job. I also want to talk about transparency. Everybody in senior care talks about being transparent. It rarely ever happens. And here's my hypothesis. I think it doesn't happen because they're afraid of the lawsuits if they open their kimono a little bit. Mm-hmm. And I see transparency, it comes down to the definition of transparency. Does anyone ever like show all the inner workings of your business? No, we don't need to do that. We don't need to know all the inner workings. We just need a communication channel about our loved one. And that's the kind of transparency that we're looking for. We're not looking for, tell me how many staff are turning over every month. And I think they're afraid that we're going to see that it has not been a pretty environment. And the reality is we know it hasn't, and we want to fix it.
Yeah. Right. We're not asking to know what's your budget and how are you spending your or whatever the case may be. It is really about we just want that communication and we want to know who's caring for my loved one. How are they eating? How are they sleeping? Are they happy? Are they doing the things that they want to do? Right. That's what it's about. And when you take away that unknown and that guesswork, then people can step into a place of, I know this is happening, and I can have confidence and trust in where they are, what's getting done, right? No one's perfect and no business is perfect, but there's grace in a lot of that when you can have communication with someone and know where people are coming from.
Yeah, and if we go back to the story that I told early on in this conversation about my mom was nonverbal, but my dad would tell me he never was fed and didn't get showered. And mm-hmm. I happened to live close enough that I was there every weekend pre-COVID. So I knew that wasn't the case. Now, my brother, who lived in Wisconsin at the time, did not know that was the case. Mm-hmm. So when he heard those things from dad, he would be on the phone with me first. What's going on down there? With the executive director of the community, why hasn't my dad been fed? And you can just imagine this going on all over the world. Right. We at Serenity, we're global. So we have people who are living all over the globe and keep in touch with their loved one's care through Serenity. Like they're not missing a beat.
Wow.
And that's another thing that helps save them time. They can avoid those types of confrontations with family members really pretty easily if they communicate. A couple of things, there's a book called Upstream that is just incredible, and it really talks about how do you solve the problem of something before it happens. Mm-hmm. And And it's the hardest thing in the world to do, because if it doesn't happen, how does anyone know that you solved it?
Yeah.
And why would someone pay for something or invest time and training and mm-hmm. effort into mm-hmm. something if they don't have the already evidence of the long litany of things that it's producing? Well, in senior care, we have that long litany of things that are not working well. So that's a great book, though, for anyone who is interested in this industry at all. I highly recommend it. The other thing is, when you have family members who are not local, they're probably the ones that you need to pay the most attention to. And executive directors, I believe, have not been trained to do the job that family thinks they're supposed to be doing. So my idea of an executive director is that person is my main point of contact. That person is the person, not my main, but they're like my go-to for most everything outside of my parents' like daily stuff. So if I'm having a problem or a question or anything, I would go to them. I have found more often than not, and I hear this in families that we talk to every single day, the executive director rarely comes out of their office. They don't know how to be customer facing. They're not in a customer service role, or they aren't trained to be in a customer service role, but that's what we expect. So there's a disconnect between what we think they're supposed to do and what their job actually is. It is very focused internal. It is not focused the way family thinks it is. So I think there's some opportunities for a change there as well.
That's exactly what's happening. We view it as this person is representing and the face of the community, for lack of a better term. And in reality, it isn't that. And so that is such a good point that you make, because that's exactly what's happening. The expectations are different.
Yeah. So it's misaligned expectations. Mm-hmm. And that goes back to the 80% of lawsuits in senior care mm-hmm. are related to the first 14 days, and it's communication and missed expectation setting, misaligned expectations.
Yeah.
And those are easy to fix.
They are.
They really are.
Yes. So for families and caregivers that really want to communicate in a different way, really want to be able to use technology or even start the conversation, how can you encourage them? What would you share with them about how they can start creating change wherever they are or wherever their loved one is at?
It's a great question. It's not as simple as asking the community to use a tool, because many of the families are hesitant to do that. So I think the first thing to do is, are you willing to advocate for your loved one? Are you willing to step into that role and be an advocate? And that means not being confrontational, but being collaborative mm-hmm. and approaching the care team. And I would probably go to the director of wellness or director of nursing first, because they tend to be your main point of contact on a regular basis. And I would ask them, hey, I know that there are tools out there that are HIPAA compliant. Would you be willing to do this with me? Because it matters. It makes my life easier. I think it will make your life easier. And I think that's how I would approach it from that side of things. You can always talk to us. We'll give you some guidance depending on your situation. We've been working with some family members that are local here, that they're all in different, they have loved ones in different communities, and every community is different. Mm-hmm. So it's worth having a quick conversation if there's interest there.
And they can find out more about Serenity on your website, right?
Yes.
And you guys are available, and you have all of your contact information on that. And so we will also link to your Serenity Engage on our episode description, and so people can find more information if they have questions, just want to have direction. That is a perfect place to start also.
That's great. Yeah, I would appreciate that, just from the perspective of, I want people to know that there are alternatives to the way that communication is happening or not happening today. Mm-hmm. And this really can make life so much easier. So whether it's Serenity or another tool, it doesn't matter. Find a way to advocate for your loved one and get the communication that you need.
There can be a smooth transition. People can navigate that really well. There can be a lot of, like you said, find the moments of joy. Mm-hmm. And there are tools available. And just even the idea that what families say and how families communicate really matters. And that's the bright light, I think.
Yeah, thank you for that. I think so too. And really, the other side to this is if family, even pre-COVID, I was there on weekends, right? So when does family visit? Nights and weekends. Mm-hmm. And the things that are happening then are usually sundowners, mm-hmm. if they have dementia, mm-hmm. or Alzheimer's. And weekends, there's shift changes. It's a lot of discombobulation. It doesn't feel the same. So what happens is family never gets to see the extraordinary care that really, truly, genuinely happens every single day.
Yeah.
And I believe Serenity gives communities a way to put a spotlight on that care, yeah. to really show off the work that their care teams are doing,
yeah.
and let family have a view into that.
Right.
And if nothing else, I hope that if I have changed one person's life, that's fulfilling for me, because nobody needs to go through stress that is completely unnecessary. And I think that we have enough stress in our life, especially with COVID, that we just need to eliminate the things that should not be causing us stress. And this is a very simple way to do that.
It's easing the burden a little bit, which is always yeah. what we need right now.
And yeah. little bits. I mean, we're in this together. Yeah. We should collaborate. We need yeah. to be collaborating and talking about our loved ones' care.
Yeah. I agree.
On a regular basis, in a conversation.
Perfect. Well, thank you, Catherine, so much for your insight and just coming alongside people and caregivers and families and communities and bringing about change and collaboration is what we all need. So thank you so much.
Oh, thank you, Nicole. I appreciate the opportunity.
So I have to tell you about Jimmy Zolo and his new company, Joe and Bella. Our paths had crossed, and I'm so glad they did. It was such a pleasure to meet Jimmy. He is passionate about older adults. He told me that after both of his grandparents moved into a care community, his family's world was turned upside down, and they really became caregivers overnight. As you know, being a caregiver to someone close to you is often overwhelming. There's so much for you to manage, even with the support of a care community, like making sure your loved one has all of the products that they need and keeping them stocked when things run out, keeping inventory on what you have and what you don't. Jimmy also had that problem, and he was scrolling through all of these product reviews across the internet, and like most of us in the sandwich generation, we don't have enough hours in the day. It can feel really overwhelming and time-consuming and frustrating. We don't know what we're always looking for. And he wished there was a way to shop for his grandparents. Then the pandemic hit, preventing visitation to care communities, making this process even more difficult. So Jimmy decided to launch his own business to solve this problem. He founded Joe and Bella to make shopping for older adults simple. They carry everything from comfy clothes to creative gifts. They even have toiletries that can be automatically reordered and tech that makes caregiving easier. Everything all in one location. What I love, and I know you guys will love too, is that each and every product on Joe and Bella has been carefully selected by caregiving experts. Jimmy is so generous. He is giving an exclusive offer to our listeners of our podcast. You can use the promo code GATHER to receive 10% off your first purchase at joeandbella.com. That code is GATHER, GATHER, for 10% off at joeandbella.com. You don't want to miss this offer. Head to their website and check it out.
Thank you for listening today. If you enjoyed our episode, please subscribe and give us 5 stars. In all honesty, we'd love to hear from you. Thank you so much for listening to our episode.